and I have to say this. 3, 2, 1, ignition set. You didn't expect me to say that, did you? Yeah. So, first of all, welcome to the University of Canterbury's UC Connect series. So we have, obviously, Tim Atkins, which is pretty awesome to have you today. Just a few things. These lectures are recorded and also will be available on YouTube, I think, about a week or maybe 2 weeks after this talk. The lectures are free, but we do ask you to register online for each one. So if you haven't already done so, can you register online to be alerted to upcoming public lectures? We hope you enjoy this evening's lectures and this lecture and return to attend others. So a bit of housekeeping. If you hear the fire alarm, please follow the UC staff instructions and follow them to the evacuation points. Remain as a group. In the unlikely event, dare I say, an earthquake, stay where you are and take shelter. So do not evacuate unless instructed by UC staff and follow instructions of UC staff. Should evacuation be necessary, the assembly point once you exit the building, and I found that out from the security officer, is outside the main C block entrance. So now the main event. So yeah, very pleased to present Tim Atkins. He manages avionics requirements, testing and analyses for key components of the Space Launch System and Human Lander at the NASA's Marshall Space Flight Center. Is it there?
You go.
Wow, yeah. Awesome. Very kindly gave me an awesome shirt, so thanks a lot, Tim, for that. So yeah, just a little bit. Tim is an Erskine fellow. He's been here for the past 4 weeks. He leaves tomorrow. I just wanted to say Tim has been an inspiration to the students, in my rocket course. So particularly in bringing your expertise and sort of experience in, like, especially like reviewing our launch procedures and technical specifications and really confirming, I think, that we're on the right track. I'm really looking forward to future collaboration and whenever you have the sort of the opportunity. You have obviously a very busy schedule leading towards SLS, I think, next year.
Yep.
But just really looking forward to future collaboration, and thanks very much, and take it away, Tim.
All right, thank you so much, Chris. All right. Thank you. Thanks, Chris, for developing a relationship here and nominating me for the Erskine Fellowship. We have some representatives from the Erskine office up there that have made my life easy the last 4 weeks. And so I really appreciate everyone's hospitality. My students, some of them are here. My former students, because no more lectures. Until after the launch of the Space Launch System, which I want to talk about. As Chris mentioned, I am a lead engineer for the Artemis program. Actually, two aspects of that, two projects in that, are the Space Launch System and the Human Lander System, and I'll talk about those in a minute. But before we get started, I need my clicker. And by way of introduction,
50 years ago, we went to the moon. We called it Apollo.
What many people don't know is that Apollo had a twin.
She was a woman named Artemis,
goddess of the moon.
We are returning to the moon.
As a new generation of explorers, this time to stay.
And to prepare to achieve humanity's next giant leap of sending the first human missions to Mars.
We believe our course will redefine what is possible.
That we will discover life-saving,
earth-changing science.
And that the challenges ahead will inspire generations.
This is our manifest.
For all who wonder if we could return.
For all who dreamed of pressing beyond.
This is your calling.
We go for all of America.
We go. We go as the Artemis generation.
We go.
Did anyone recognize the last gentleman there, the older gentleman that spoke?
Abe
Krantz, yeah, Gene Krantz. He was the flight director on the ground 50 years ago for the Apollo missions. And he was the one when the astronauts had trouble on Apollo 13 that they radioed down and said, Houston, we've had a problem. Well, he helped them take care of that problem. And if for those who have not seen the movie Apollo 13, or maybe your children haven't, I'd highly recommend it. Before we talk about the future of space exploration, I'd like to take a look at the past, right? What drives humanity to do certain things? And I just gave four examples here. A couple of them are dear to your heart and dear to my heart. My understanding is about 1,000 years ago were when the first humans arrived here in New Zealand. Then a little over 100 years ago, it's when a group of Norwegian men finally made it to the South Pole. And of course, probably the most famous Kiwi, at least in my lifetime, is Sir Hilary and Tenzing Norgay, who were the first to ascend Everest. And then just a few months ago, we celebrated the 50th anniversary of a major event really throughout the world when the first humans landed on the moon. And what I like to bring out about each one of these stories is the extensive risk, the extensive time, and even the loss of life it took to achieve these goals. Each one of these adventures was preceded by efforts that were so-called failures, that weren't really failures. They paved the way. People learned from those activities and were able to achieve these destinations. So there's something within the human spirit that, let's put it this way, there's something within many people's spirit that drive them to these locations that humans have never been before. So I'm not an astronaut, so I'll say that up front. I enable the astronauts. I build machines for the astronauts to enable them to do things like this. So the question is, who's going to be the first human on Mars, or humans? I did want to add to that first video, there was a statement that says, we do this for all of America. We actually do it for all the world. And you're going to see several instances where NASA is bringing in international partners to be part of this mission. And hopefully I'll be able to tell you how these endeavors impact the world. They have and they will. By the way, Mars, if you want to try to track Mars or tell your children how to, there's an app that you can get to, I believe one of them is called Star Tracker, or not Star Tracker, there's another name. Anyway, you can find the app about tracking planets. And Mars right now is pretty much following the sun, so you can't see it that well. But later on in the year, you can. So when you do see it, just think about, you know, who might be the first humans there. For those young people, let's see, who's under the age of 20 around here? I hope by the time that your hair looks like mine, that you will have witnessed or heard of the first humans on Mars. There's a lot of conditions. Each one of those major explorations took decades, and this is going to be no different. So, I did want to talk about where NASA is, where humans are now in space, and the scope of where we're going. So right now, the space station orbits the Earth roughly 400 km above the Earth. Which is on this scale, about a centimeter or so. So we're really not that far. high Earth orbit is about here on this scale. Well, to the moon on the scale is probably to the back of the auditorium from here. We've done that before. NASA's done that before. We're going to do it again. And I'll talk about how that's a platform for us even going further. Mars is a different story. On this scale, it's between 1 and 8 K away from, I'm sorry, 1 to 8 million K away from the, I'm trying to get those units. On this scale, 1 to 8 kilometers away. All right, so why such a variation? Well, there's sometimes that Earth and Mars are on the same side of the sun because Mars has an orbit of roughly 2 of our years. There's times we're on the opposite side of the sun. So when we think about missions to Mars, we need to plan those missions, obviously, where Earth and Mars will be generally on the same side of the sun. But that's the scale of what we're talking about. Now, NASA is helping to commercialize low Earth orbit to actually subsidize the private sector to develop capabilities for regular launches into low Earth orbit. The nature of those launches and the frequency of those launches are such that we believe there's a strong commercial market that can support that. We're also continuing research on the space station to solve problems related to people being in space for long periods. So one of the experiments that's being done involves two twin astronauts, the Kelly twins, and they've taken turns. One stays on Earth while the other is on the space station for long durations. And then physicians can measure the effect of those exposures to space on their bodies and get a very granular picture of what's going on in terms of microgravity and other effects of space on the human body. The next phase is to build what we call the Deep Space Gateway, which is like a space station around the moon. And from there, we will initiate the deep space transport, which will be a special vehicle to carry astronauts into deep space from that gateway. Phase two is to complete that transport system and then begin to conduct Mars simulation missions where humans will travel further and further away from the moon and Earth system to deeper and deeper into space, eventually to Mars, eventually to other deep space destinations. And of course, the final phase is to explore Mars in person. One of the projects I'm working on is SLS, which is a rocket that's going to perform key roles throughout. Okay. This is a initial concept for the gateway, which is right there in the middle. It's a small space station. It will have an associated landing system, which is already, we've already started to develop requirements for that. It will transport astronauts to and from the lunar surface. And over on the right here, is a depiction of the Orion service module that transports astronauts from Earth to the gateway or to the moon directly. Now this picture shows a set of candidate orbits that the gateway can take around the moon. The moon is right there in the middle of those ellipses, and what this shows is a set of candidate orbits that takes very little energy to maintain. Once you get an object in one of those orbits, it takes very minimal energy to keep it there. It's very advantageous for a space station around the moon. The difficulty is the length of that orbit is about 6.5 days. So once, and we can only drop off or retrieve astronauts down here. So what that means is when we drop off astronauts, it's like, okay guys, see you in a week. We'll be back. Hope nothing goes wrong, but we will design safety into whatever systems they use to enable them to survive. Now, we talk about the exposure in space to certain adverse conditions. We're talking about, for the space station now, returning to Earth takes about a few hours, which is not so bad. I can tell you it's a lot better than coming to New Zealand from the States. And we've done that. We've been doing that for decades, right? We've pretty much got it down. And to the moon, it's a bit longer. We've done that before. It takes a few days to come back or to go there. The reentry temperature is a little bit warmer. Well, a lot warmer. But we've learned to protect astronauts from that. Mars will take several months. The velocities and reentry temperatures are not that much different. But the real key here is exposure to space radiation. The Earth has something called a magnetic field that protects us from the majority of the damaging radiation in space. It extends actually far out. And there's a little bit of protection even towards the moon. But back when humans went to the moon, during their entire mission, they were exposed to the equivalent of roughly 2 to 3 X-rays of radiation, which isn't so bad. But when you talk about a mission that lasts 9 months there, 9 months back, and however long you're going to stay on Mars, we're talking about a significant exposure to radiation. So NASA's working on new suits, new capsules, environments that will protect astronauts from that. But it's a huge problem. Okay, before I start on this, this will introduce you to the Space Launch System, which is the rocket that I'm helping develop.
Humanity is on the verge of a journey into deep space. But before we can return to the moon, and before we can visit Mars, or any of the worlds beyond, we have to take the first step. First step into deep space. This is the Space Launch System.
So just before we started, I met someone who worked on the space shuttle program. Gary, where are you? Does that make you want to come back to work?
That would be great.
Yeah. Excuse me, let me get some water here. I'm sorry, that wasn't mine. Okay, I want to tell you where I live and why. This shows the United States, which in area is roughly about the same size as Australia. And it shows, it designates the headquarters for NASA and 10 NASA centers, each of which has a unique set of capabilities. And the Center for NASA's Rocket Propulsion is here in at Marshall Space Flight Center in Alabama. So, most people, when they think of Alabama, they don't necessarily think about space or rocketry. So what do y'all think about when you think of Alabama?
Forrest Gump.
Forrest Gump, good answer. What else? What kind of weather? Yes, a lot of tornadoes at certain times of the year, for sure. The Alabama Crimson Tide. My dad went to Alabama. My brother went to the rival school, Auburn. I ended up at University of Central Florida. What did someone say back there?
One, two.
Do you mean this? Alabama is my sweet home. Here's a good song. I'm not going to listen to the whole thing. I can't talk over it. So download it and listen to it. It actually about 55 or so years ago, there was a German rocket scientist and engineer named Wernher von Braun, and he had escaped the Nazis, came to the United States with a group of German researchers and scientists who had worked on the rocket program in Germany with the desire of civil human space exploration. And when he came to the States, he continued that. One of the amazing things about von Braun is that he was a brilliant engineer and he was a brilliant communicator. And he was very much a people person. And he was uniquely used to bring his vision of human space exploration. And the United States bought into it. And of course, also what fueled that was the space race back with the Soviet Union. But of all places he could have chosen, he had the most influence in developing Marshall Space Flight Center there in Alabama. He said it reminded him of home. So go figure. A little bit about SLS. I'm not going to go into much detail here, except to say in terms of the combination of volume, the volume it can carry, the mass it can carry, and the speed at which it can deliver it. It's going to be a one-of-a-kind vehicle. We're talking about over 45 tons of payload towards the moon, which can go a long way to delivering an infrastructure for the Gateway and for cargo to the moon to develop an infrastructure on the moon.
NASA astronaut,
and this is SLS. Okay, let me back up, start over, because I'm going to turn up the volume here. And if you think my accent is funny, this guy's great, though. Come on. Here we go.
Hi, I'm Butch Wilmore, NASA astronaut, and this is SLS in 60 seconds. Let's use this. We've been in low Earth orbit since 1972, and SLS is the only human-rated rocket that's going to take us beyond low Earth orbit to far destinations. Very unique. The Space Launch System is the only rocket that can launch huge payloads and humans to far destinations well beyond low Earth orbit. Well, I'll tell you what, we go through many design reviews, hundreds to the process of designing this rocket. I mean, looking at everybody, even the metallurgy of the bolts that put this thing together. That makes me feel comfortable. It makes my family feel comfortable. We're ready to launch. Oh, testing. Well, let's take the core stage, for example. We twist it, we bend it, we pull it, we do all kinds of stuff all the way across this nation. Like right now, this is the ending section. And oh, by the way, this has been SLS in 60 seconds.
So as an astronaut, he has very much a say into how SLS is developed, how the Orion capsule is developed. They're taking the risk, right? Our job is to make it as safe as possible for them. And I spoke with one astronaut who shed light on his perspective. He says, he basically said, guys, we know we're taking the risk. We just ask you be honest with us and be free with your information. Let us know the risks with as much detail and clarity as you know, and we'll make the decision. And they've had to make the decision. Sometimes they've called off a launch. Sometimes they have been faced with a decision to call off a launch, and they went ahead and did it. So these are the heroes. I'm just helping them. Okay, how big is SLS? Well, if you lay it down, it could pretty much cover a rugby field. We've got two different, actually, we have more than two versions, but this shows for the initial configuration, the crewed version that will carry astronauts in that Orion capsule, right about there, and the cargo version that is uncrewed. In terms of mass, it will weigh empty. The empty weight is roughly 2,500 metric tons. And I like to tell folks that a metric ton is roughly the mass of a Mini Cooper. So if you could imagine stacking 2,500 of those up, you're looking at the unfueled mass that we have to get away from Earth's gravity. How does SLS fly? So I like to use someone, I'd like to request that someone that knows how to use a cricket bat to come, and you gotta have a good sense of balance too. So any takers? All right, I might have to get one of my Erskine friends to come down. I gotta need someone with a decent sense of balance. You're not gonna do this. You're not going to do that, but I will ask you to come and do a little demo for me. Andrew. Yeah. Just. So Andrew did not volunteer, but he's been one of my students, and this is worth how much for his grade? All right, so, yeah. So we want SLS to go like this, right? This is actually kind of the shape of it. There's the boosters on the side. We'll talk about that. But SLS is propelled from the bottom. So if you would, Andrew, just keep that balanced in your hand. You can grip it if you need to. And I want to illustrate, or maybe you don't need to. Look at that, wow. Okay, so what is going on here is that Andrew has sensors in his eyes and in his hand, mainly, that are carrying signals to his brain that tell you, that tells him the orientation of this thing to keep it up. What happens is there's signals that go back to his hand and actuate the base of this bat to keep it going up. All right, thank you. Good job. Well, in principle, that's exactly how a rocket works. So there are sensors throughout the vehicle measuring where the rocket is and how it's oriented and how fast it's going. And that information is fed into the computers, the flight computers, which many times a second this happens. Many times a second, the flight computers send out commands to these actuators. So all of those engines down here at the bottom can actuate and give the change the thrust vector the direction that the rocket's going. So many times a second, it's a complex problem. If you're interested in engineering and math, come to UC and take Dr. Hand's rocket course and other math and science courses, physics. It's a tremendous problem, and there's always ways to make that better. And that's one of the things Dr. Hand and his group's doing. Okay, the Orion spacecraft is the capsule that sits on top of the rocket. This is where the astronauts ride, and it's about as big as the center part of this this platform down here. You can see the types of that's in Fahrenheit. I need to change that. You can see the types of heat and velocity and some other environments that they're exposed to. I do want to point out here the service module. This is the service module that provides all of the power and oxygen and other services to the Orion capsule. It's developed by the European Space Agency. That's just one example of how this and future endeavors or NASA will be international. At the top here, you'll see something that looks like a rocket. Well, that's a little rocket. It's an escape system. So if anything goes wrong here underneath with the main space launch system, then the astronauts can basically eject, and this rocket will propel them a short distance to safety, and they can land in the ocean. All right, I want to talk about the main elements of SLS now. On each side are two solid rocket boosters. These are these boosters burn for about the first 2 minutes of flight. They like kickstart the rocket to get through the troposphere. And I'll go into more detail about that later. There are four engines at the bottom of this core stage. These are the most powerful engines of their kind. Oops. PowerPoint. Where did you go? Okay, four engines at the bottom of the core stage. So when the boosters fall off, the core stage continues flying with these engines for about another 8 minutes. The core stage, what you're looking at here is mostly fuel tanks, a massive hydrogen tank here, liquid hydrogen, and an oxygen tank on top. With some other space for avionics, which is what I work on. The upper stage actually sits on top of that. So after 10 minutes of flight, the upper stage continues to accelerate and push the Orion capsule around the orbit, get it out of orbit towards the moon. And there is an Orion stage adapter that's actually pretty big space right here that we use for additional satellites as part of the mission. And finally, the Orion capsule's on top. So that's kind of the architecture at a high level. I'm gonna talk more about these elements. Okay, so the five segment SRBs, the solid rocket boosters, also called boosters. If you hear me say SRB or booster, it's the same thing. So, these are proven heritage boosters that were used on the shuttle. The shuttle had four segments. The boosters here have five for SLS. So 20% more fuel. Each one of them will burn through about 5.5 tons of fuel a second and generate a tremendous amount of thrust. Here is one of the tests that we did. The astronaut talked about the level of testing that we do. Well, we have to do that at every level from the smallest component to the larger elements, and finally the rocket itself. So this is one of the segments that was loaded. I don't want to do that. Okay, you get to watch it twice. Okay, so this is one of the segments, and what you're going to see is them load it inside a building to be conditioned at a certain temperature. So we had two tests, one at a very cold temperature, one at a very warm temperature. They rolled the building back, and what you'll see here in very slow motion is the ignition that shows a shock wave coming from the nozzle, and those little pieces of a throat plug that protect the fuel. And now is you'll see in the real time test here. You also see the nozzle actuate there. Like I mentioned before, all of these engines actuate to a certain level to steer the rocket. Okay, the engines. These also are the same engines that were used for the space shuttle. They've been advanced since the shuttle days. And they're instead of, the shuttle had three of these engines, SLS is gonna have four. Very efficient, the most reliable and efficient rocket engines of this class there are. If your car engine was as efficient as one of these, it would be about the size of your fist. So this is why, one of the reasons that NASA chose them, one of the main reasons is it's proven and safe, right? So here's one of the engine tests. You'll notice this is in Mississippi. We have several centers around with different capabilities. This is where we test the engines, right beside them or near the Mississippi River. So what you're seeing here is an engine that ignites liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen. What happens when you burn hydrogen and oxygen? What is that stuff? That's right, it's just pure water, steam, very clean fuel. Okay, the core stage is the biggest single element of SLS. It has a liquid hydrogen, see the installation of the hydrogen tank in the test facility. So what this facility will do, this is actually a test version of the hydrogen tank. They'll load it in this facility and have actuators on both ends and twist it, bend it, torque it, and to ensure that it's gonna withstand the forces and the environments in flight. When I think about what they're doing here with this and all of the other elements, the facilities that we have to test, these pieces are, I think, more impressive than the rocket itself when it comes to it. It's just phenomenal to think of all the work that went into this. So what happens is, though, this is a liquid hydrogen tank. So when it's filled up with very cold liquid hydrogen, you know, that's just, 20 or so degrees above absolute zero. The tank shrinks by about 15 centimeters. And the oxygen tank also shrinks proportionally. And so there's all kinds of engineering problems you have to deal with. And this is one of them. All of the connectors and hoses have to be flexible to facilitate that change in structure. This is gonna show each component of the core stage. So that's the engine section being loaded into its test facility. That's at the bottom, That's the structure that holds the four RS-25 engines. This is the hydrogen tank being loaded into its test stand. There's an intertank that is a small section between the hydrogen and oxygen tank that is used for a lot of components. A lot of the avionics are there. And then the oxygen tank sits on top of that. The hydrogen tank itself is about 40 meters tall. When they put the oxygen tank and then the inner tank section on top of that, the whole core stage is about 65 meters. It's the largest stage ever built for any kind of space flight. There's something else I was going to say. Okay, this is the in-space stage, which is called the ICPS, or the Interim Cryogenic Propulsion Stage. It also uses liquid hydrogen. That's where the term cryogenic comes from. And I was going to mention, this will show you the development of the in-space stage, but is anybody here familiar with friction stir welding? It's a special technique used for making very strong welds, and that's what was used to weld the tanks. The tanks that you see here are use friction stir welding. There's the largest welder of that kind in the world at the development facilities here. And that aircraft is called a Guppy. It's big enough to transport a large element of SLS. Okay. So we're nearing the final stages of testing, right? We're putting each of those large elements through extensive testing, and later, the early part of next year, we're going to start the green run test, which is the entire core stage and engines assembled in one facility. Then we're going to take that down to Kennedy Space Center and assemble that with the other components and have the test flight. This is going to be the first Artemis flight, and it's going to be a test flight. There's going to be not astronauts, but dummies in the Orion capsule with sensors on them to measure the effects of the flight on them. And the after the launch, SLS is going to push one orbit around the Earth. It takes that long to generate enough velocity to get it away from the Earth's gravity. And then the Orion capsule is going to actually go further than any other manned vehicle has ever been, a little bit further past the moon than we were before, and then come back and deploy parachutes into the Pacific Ocean. So with that,
we will return American astronauts to the moon, not only to leave behind footprints and flags, but to build the foundation we need to send Americans to Mars and beyond.
Feel that.
Styx gave NASA the license to use that song. Yeah. That being said, there are some pretty awesome musicians that I work with. So, about a year from now, keep your eye on the news. Depending on how well the rest of the next year's testing goes, we'll be on the pad and ready to launch, hopefully by a year from November. Don't miss it. So I think now is when I'll take questions.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Here's some questions. So, yeah, she's going to bring you a microphone. If you have a question, just raise your hand.
Can grab that? Can you give me a hand? 1 second. I need a... Just before you start. Yeah, so the rules of questions. So you try to keep specific to one question, and we'll try and give both sides a go. So, yes, Andrew, if you could give me a hand. And we'll, if you can do that side. And just go up there. That'd be great. First question.
Did you already show how the size of the Artemis compares to the size of the Apollo? Just wondering at the difference of the size.
It's a little, very good question. Compared to the Apollo rocket, the whole stack is slightly longer. No, it's about the same though, yeah. The initial version. I forgot to mention that early in the SLS program, they planned for evolvability. So what you're gonna see after the first version, or the first configuration, are advanced boosters, and then a more capable upper stage. And each one of those is gonna add to the power lift capabilities, which are important for additional velocity. Once you get out in space, it's not just what you're getting there, how much you're getting there, or what size of the payload, but what kind of energy or velocity it has when it is in its desired orbit.
Hi, I just have a question. So SpaceX is developing Starship. What's the advantage of SLS compared to there?
Well, there he asked about SLS and SpaceX and other commercial partners, Blue Origin. What we're gonna see is, over the next couple decades, is how commercially viable certain commercial solutions are. Obviously, it's not advantageous to rely on one supplier. The more suppliers you have, the better. Each one of those is gonna have a different capability. Over time, each one of those is gonna develop a potential commercial viability, if you will, and they will develop their own track record of safety. So those are all factors in how any particular private company, or NASA for that matter, will be able to see a particular design or implementation happen. So, but those kinds of questions really won't be answered for decades, I believe.
Thanks. I was wondering, for the moon to Mars leg, are you guys looking at like different types of fuel systems, or is the plan to actually have a hydrogen oxygen plant on the moon, getting it out
yes,
of that's, water or,
right.
or
so,
different sort of
you might have heard that the first Artemis missions will be geared towards the south pole of the moon, and there are ice reserves there. So, as we discover how to harvest that, I believe that what one solution they're looking at is using the hydrogen there for fuel. There's also another technology, nuclear thermal propulsion, which is a very efficient, it has a very good combination of fuel efficiency and thrust, okay? Much more thrust than, say, an ion propulsion system has. So I think you're gonna see those two technologies implemented in different forms as we talk about moving from the moon to deep space.
Thank you for the talk. I have a question. In the animation, I saw a lot of satellites flying around the Earth, and at the same time, the rock is going through them. Do you guys worry about they will collide with each other?
There are, that is becoming an increasing problem. But the satellites can navigate. If they're in the way, there's ways to get them out of the way. So it's manageable now. Now, you know, there's been talk of thousands more satellites in the future being deployed. That will become a problem. Space clutter. But, yeah.
Right, thank you.
Hi, you were talking about the problems with exposure to radiation during these very long space flights into outer space. And you said there might be technological fixes to protect astronauts, you know, the capsule as well as the spacesuits themselves. What exactly is the technological fix, unless it's a secret? Can you tell us, please?
Well, no, they're publicly available on the web. They're just looking at different materials now, lightweight materials that are protective. That's the trade-off that they're looking at now. I do know that boron is in one of the materials they're looking at, but all that material is available on the web. And really out of my expertise, but I have friends that are working on that.
Next year when the rocket takes off, how long will it take for it to go from Earth around the moon and back?
Yeah, that's a good question. How long is that test mission and future missions gonna take? That will take a few days, 4 days, I believe, until it, from launch to reentry.
Thank you.
Hi, I have a question here. Are you going to use any artificial intelligence systems actually on board that will have a control function of their own, or how much of that will be delegated back to Houston or Kennedy?
Well, that's a good question. I wouldn't use the term artificial intelligence so much as being self-guided. All the systems that you saw here, except for Orion, are self-guided. So, and I guess you could call it artificial intelligence, just like Andrew was balancing that bat. That took quite a bit of intelligence. So that's what function is going to be like with the SLS computers and other, for also the ICPS.
Oh, he's up there.
Any parts of it reusable?
Only the Orion capsule. So what that means is, after 2 minutes of flight, the boosters detach. By the way, each booster has a number of bolts that are like 30 kilograms each. And those bolts have to explode. And they have to explode in a certain direction. So there's another engineering problem. Does anybody like to build things? Show your hand. Yeah. So there's all kinds of things that have to happen to make this work. So yeah, the boosters drop in the ocean, the core stage drops in the ocean, and then ICPS will have a disposal maneuver, and its carcass will burn up on reentry or go into deep space. That's a good question, though. And I get, you know, I've presented at some primary schools, and it's really neat how there's always one of the students that's very concerned, as we should be, about, well, what happens when these huge objects fall in the ocean? And so we think about that, right? But what I like to think about is, did you know there are like 3 million shipwrecks at the bottom of the ocean? We're adding a few. Hopefully they'll make nice habitats for some creatures down there.
Okay. Yeah.
How far you are away from, you said about nuclear thermal propulsion. How far you are away with the technology to be used?
last year, the NASA got some specific funding to accelerate that development. And I think it's going to be necessary for humans to explore deep space because, it, like I say, it's a combination of efficiency and a relatively small amount of fuel compared to the big oxygen hydrogen tanks you see there, and thrust. So, but in terms of when, that question is being answered now.
Will you guys be looking at building civil structures on the moon? If so, what would be issues or complications?
Yeah, those, right. So if you're talking about a facility to extract ice, water, and create hydrogen fuel, yes, that's one of the potential facilities we're looking at. And those concepts are being developed now. So what we're going to see, we've got a lot of technologies being worked in parallel, and that's one of them. And it's going to take some when humans land on the moon in roughly 5 years, that will be one of their missions, is to begin studying and conceptualizing firsthand what needs to be done and bringing data back for that. So that's a good question.
Hi. Thank you for the talk. Mm-hmm. I was just wondering, has the whole program been fully funded by your government?
It is now.
It is now?
Yes. So that's a good question. We never know what to expect between administrations and congresses, but one of the good things about SLS is that we have work distributed throughout the nation, which keeps a lot of the congressional support solid for a long time. So that's been one of the things that stabilized the funding for SLS.
This side? Yeah.
Hi. You talked about harvesting water from the moon and so forth. What sustainability guidelines are set up at NASA? Or who governs those, and how do you assess those?
I have not assessed those sustainability guidelines.
Sorry?
I have not assessed those. I don't know about the sustainability guidelines for that.
Okay, but just in general, do you have a group of people there that, if you're going to use resources on a global scale or out there, does someone assess that? You'd have a group of people at NASA that assess that?
Definitely.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not involved with that effort though.
All right, you win it. That's okay. I'll let you then when we have to go. Got to keep it even.
With the recognition by the American Air Force that there are UFOs, do you think you're in competition with these other mysterious aircraft that fly around? And what kind of technical problems do you think they've overcome?
Not to my knowledge. Yeah. I'll have to go talk with Air Force folks about that.
I think we'll quickly move on to that.
One question which seems a little strange. Why do we send humans in these spacecraft? Is it only to check what we don't know we don't know? Because otherwise they seem to be useless.
Yeah. And what you're saying is it's an ongoing debate, right? Because we can make robots do a lot of things, right? We could send robots to Antarctica, to the South Pole. We could have sent them to Everest. There's something within many humans that want to be there. There are certain things that we cannot learn without experiencing as humans. But that's a very valid question. Some people, and rightfully so, question the effort that goes into human exploration in general, right, of anything. All the other explorations I showed up here had similar questions. Let me just, if I could, show a, since you've... Let's see here. Okay, yeah, this is it. One of our astronauts that passed away during the Apollo program, this was in his heart. He knew the risk. He said, if we die, we want people to accept it. We're in a risky business, and we hope that if anything happens to us, it will not delay the program. His drive, his opinion, conquest of space is worth the risk of life. Our God-given curiosity will force us to go there ourselves, because in the final analysis, only man or humans can fully evaluate the moon in terms understandable to other men. So not everybody has the vision to go to these remote places, but many do. And I believe that when I look at the effort and the expense of making that happen in the context of Moon or Mars, I look at it in one way as the a very small percentage of our national budget, if you will. The entire NASA budget is less than a half of 1% of the US budget. So in the grand scheme of things, is that fraction of, and that's the whole NASA budget. That's not, the human spaceflight is a part of that. So in the grand scheme of things, is that fraction worth the effort to support explorers like this? And the more I think about it, the more I think, yeah. Also remember is the effort and the expense is not just to scratch the itch of an explorer, because what we've seen, what's been borne out over the decades, is that when you stretch the boundaries of human existence and do quote impossible things, there are so many benefits that come from that. Every month NASA publishes their spin-off technologies that they make available to the public. By law, NASA has to make those things public unless they're military secrets. So you can actually Google NASA spin-off, go to that website and see what, for that month, what are some of the technologies that benefit everybody, right? Not just Americans. I recall back in the 1970s, a famous author in the Americas testified before Congress, and he had just undergone a heart surgery that was successful, repaired his heart, and he attributed four NASA technologies to that particular surgery that he believes would not have been possible without the Apollo space program, by the way, which cost about $150 billion in today's money. That's billion with a B. Is it worth it? I think so.
Hey, I'll keep it going. Yep. We a little more. Yep, can I continue?
This is a question. Do you have a department that works through difficult ethical scenarios that might arise? Are you going to save this astronaut, that astronaut?
Which one? What was the example you gave?
Do you work through difficult ethical scenarios that might arise when things go wrong? Who are you going to save if you can only bring one person back?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there are the astronaut corps has an entire division devoted to that kind of thing. Yeah, I don't work with that directly. I thought he was going to ask about the potential conflict, you know, when we're talking about who owns the moon. I think it's going to be much like what happened in Antarctica, that, you know, there was a treaty back in the 1950s to kind of divvy up the pie, and we'll see something like that happen with space assets, I'm sure.
That time was running out.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Is there anyone? You can keep going. I think I can go to 15:15.
Okay.
As for progress towards actually getting to the moon, if you compare SLS and SpaceX's Starship program, how would you say they compare?
In terms of the moon program?
Progress towards, like, how many years away they are from actually getting there.
The plan is to have the next humans on the moon in 5 years.
And
a lot of that depends on continued government funding.
And how does that compare to the Starship program from SpaceX?
I'm not familiar with SpaceX.
With regard to the actual moon landings, how regular do you envisage them being, and how long do you imagine them staying on the surface?
Yeah, so right now, I showed you those orbits that are about a week. Right now, by definition, the initial missions are going to be about a week, and there'll be multiples of a week based on those orbits. So in terms of the frequency, that depends a lot on the success of the missions, what they discover, and subsequent government support. So theoretically, you know, I could stand up here and say, theoretically, if money was no object, I could give you a much better answer or quicker answer, but money is an object. You know, back in the 1960s, NASA had about 6% of the national federal budget. They had a blank check because there was so much more national interest and priority, and most of that 6% was getting people to the moon. So it's a different game now.
Hi there. I'd like to know, how much larger can the payloads get when it comes to using these current propulsion systems, these SRBs and that? Is there a point where it's not, we're not able to continue increasing these payloads because it's not sustainable?
That's a very good question. I think that's why, over time, they're going to be looking at options as we develop. For example, as SLS configurations evolve, and as deep space propulsion systems are developed, there's going to be a trade-off about what missions. I mean, you can build up quite a bit of capability on that gateway or on the moon, and then from there, ostensibly have a much less, much smaller engines to carry you to deep space. I think that's going to be the solution.
Hey, Tim. How much are international partners contributing to making SLS a reality, and who are some of those partners?
I mentioned the European Space Agency. They're the main one. They've got some work on other components. In terms of the satellites, I didn't talk much about the 13 satellites that are going to be dropped off during the first test mission. It's not just going to be testing for the Orion capsule. It's going to drop off 13 spacecraft. Remember, I told you about that. So the Japan Space Agency has a number of those spacecraft as well.
Will the LPL in Tucson be involved?
Say again?
Will the LPL in Tucson be involved, Lunar and Planetary Laboratory?
Not directly with Artemis.
Short question, cool.
Yeah.
I think it was you, then we'll go through, and then. No.
I guess just to find out from kind of your area, what is the most difficult thing in terms of the launch? At what point is the system working the hardest to keep that rocket heading in the right direction?
Yes, that's a very good question. I'm going to say probably during the first 5 minutes of flight, as you go through the, basically through the atmosphere, right? It's definitely when the most acceleration happens and most of the vibration. That reminds me, one of the moonwalkers said, he was asked about what the most surprising part of the whole mission was. And he said, there's one thing, there's one aspect of the whole flight that they could not simulate. And he said, at launch, you're just being thrown around like a rag doll. It's just vibration like you could not imagine. He said, there's no way they could prepare for that. The rest of it, they could pretty much simulate. But I thought that was interesting because that's when the most severe environments happen early in flight.
I think it was here. Yeah.
I was wondering, where does Elon Musk fit in there?
So NASA is working in partnership with SpaceX and other commercial companies to, NASA is actually subsidizing commercial companies to build up their capabilities and to, over time, find a find capabilities that are commercially viable. And that's kind of in an experimental stage because there will come a point where NASA will not, where the commercial companies should be off on their own, generating their own income from customers. And NASA may be one of those customers if they can provide services at lower cost, right? But mentioned before, in terms of how that works out economically, it's gonna take at least a decade to understand where the private companies can contribute the most, because at some point they have to act like a private company, right? And yeah.
Isn't he talking about going to Mars next year?
Okay.
How quick? Yeah, getting close.
Just one question, Tim. Brett here. The rocket that you're building, it has liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen in it. How do you separate those two liquids safely? Because in the past there's been issues.
Yeah, they've pretty much worked through, that's what the space shuttle used for decades. It's dangerous, right, to handle anyway, but they've worked through a lot of the most significant issues.
There was one that had been there for a while, maybe up there, and just a couple more. You're not allowed me. Well, tell me.
That's a good question. I think that for a long time, NASA's resources were focused on the low Earth orbit, the space station research, and really we're at a point of commercializing that area of space. We believe that's one area of space that is really commercially viable for to have repetitive launches in more commercial interest in that.
I think, yeah, we might have to call it there, unfortunately, but yeah. If you could carry it on. That's afterwards, right, yeah. And I'm being told here from the powers that be that there's obviously a lot of interest, so I just thanks again for Tim, it's just been amazing having you here, and yeah. I just thanks for that.